want to let you know, I just love you guys this morning. I love this church. I love the sweet presence of God. And I love the peace that comes when we just linger. When you look through Scripture, the disciples got revelation when they lingered with Jesus. When Jesus would speak to the crowds and then the disciples would go with Jesus, and that's where Jesus brought that revelation of what he just spoke. So be encouraged that when you decide to linger with Jesus, that's where revelation can come in your life. Last week we spoke of how of salvation and how we're saved in the process of being saved. That when we confess, when we make that decision, we're saved. But then we enter into this process of healing, that salvation is healing, and that we become saved. He heals the broken areas of our lives. And so I want to continue on with that this morning. And I believe it's going to encourage you that the truth of when you ask yourself questions, when you look at your life and you see areas where you might feel stuck. Anybody ever go through a season or you feel an area of life where you feel stuck? You just can't feel like you can't get up out of it. Maybe it's a financial situation. You try to get out of debt, but then debt meets you when you finally start making progress. Maybe it's a relationship situation where you thought you were in a right relationship with somebody and something happens, you get out of that, you feel God heals you, you get in another relationship, but then the same cycle starts to happen. Maybe there's a cycle you see in your life where you thought you were healed, but then you go back in and the cycle repeats itself. How many of you know the devil wants to keep you stuck? He does not want to see you move forward. He does not want to see you enter into what God has called you to do. He does not want you to live life and live it to the abundance. The devil wants to keep you trapped, wants to keep you out, wants to keep you in your pits. But Jesus reveals the way of how we can have strength in this life, how we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. If you open your Bibles, our scripture this morning, I want to look at Galatians 5:24. And this is Paul talking, and it says, Paul reminds us that those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. We've seen that scripture as you've just read your Bible, and we hear, okay, we're supposed to crucify our lives. We're supposed to crucify our flesh. We're supposed to bear a cross. That's at the core of what Christianity is all about. Now to a new believer or someone new in the faith, when you tell them, hey, you got to take your cross, I'm like, well, what are you talking about? Do I got to go get a cross outside, build one, and take it with me everywhere? What do you mean by that? So it's important that I want to dissect this of what does it mean to take your cross? What does it mean when Paul says we crucify the flesh, and the key words here are with its passions and desires. As we're in this healing journey of life, in this process, he wants to heal our passions and our desires. So, Pastor Garrett, what are passions, what are desires that we have within us? Well, the evil passions we have within us are the broken, crippled passions. Jesus reveals to us in Mark 7:21 through 23. Look what the word says. It says, from within, out of the heart of man comes evil thoughts, fornication, theft, murder, adultery, coveted, wickedness, deceit, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these things come from within and they defile a man. So these are the passions, the desires that are innate within a man that if not crucified, as Paul says, if not brought before the cross, not laid down at the altar, they can take control of your life. That there's those evil things that when we become saved, Jesus Christ and by the power of the Holy Spirit wants to sanctify our lives, wants to heal our lives where these passions don't control you. You look at all the passions listed there. That's what brings destruction in the world around us. That's what brings destruction in relationships, in marriages, are these evil, broken, crippled passions. Now, there's this doctrine that's out there that some churches, denominations hold, and it's known as the doctrine of original sin, which summed up short, it says that when we were born into this world, we were born lawbreakers. We were born lawbreakers. But that's not true. I want to reveal, dig in a little deeper to this. And what we talked last week, we weren't born lawbreakers. We were born crippled. We were born fractured. And that's why we have to take everything and who we are to Christ and allow him to heal those areas in our life. Because when you And when you see yourself born as a lawbreaker, you see God as this tyrant who wants to punish you because you broke the law. God never wants to punish. His intent for us was not to punish us. His intent for us was to heal us, to heal those areas of our life. And when we bring these passions, these desires before Christ, he heals those areas. He takes the crippled areas of our lives and he brings healing to them. And so we have to know that nothing you ever do, nothing I ever do can ever change how much God loves us, how much he loves you. That's not on the line when you mess up. His love for you never changes. And if you don't get that at the foundation of your faith, then you're going to be wondering how God views you, how he sees you. Is he a good father? Is he a bad father? What's going on? Why is this happening? Is it God's fault? Is he punishing me? That's not who God is. And so you have to know that when you fall short, when you mess up, God is not mad at you. He does not want to punish you. He loves you. Now, like Bevere said in our study Wednesday night, he gave an example of him as a father and his four boys, that he loves his four boys with everything within him. He loves his sons. But now it's up to them how much he is pleased with them. That's their decision, how pleased he is with his sons. He loves them, but it's up to us of how we please him. So we, all of us here, we want to please God with everything within us, don't we? We want to please God with what we do with our lives. We want to hit the target. We want to know what he's called us to do so we can please God. But we have to take these passions within us. That's why Pastor Joyce prays the blessing every service, that he would heal us mentally, that we would take our mind and make and let it be transformed into the mind of Christ. But we have to be intentional with it. We just can't sit around and expect our feelings and our emotions to come into line. We have to be intentional and allow our mind to be formed and shaped the way Christ wants us to think, wants us to see things. That's what we talked about last week. We don't want to be lazy Christians. We just don't want to sit around and wait for something to poof and happen. We want to be intentional. We want to go after it. We want to take it and get it. We just don't want to sit around and wait. So we have to know that we're born crippled. We're born fractured. When we fell, we're born fractured. We're not born lawbreakers. And so we have to, as Bree was praying the Lord's Prayer, I thought of this, of when we pray that his kingdom come, his will be done. You know the reason we pray the will of God be done in our life? It's because our will is fractured. It's crippled. It's broken. So that's why we pray, your will be done. Come and heal my will and make it into your will. There's this transfer of things that come where we take these crippled passions, these desires that aren't of God, where, like I shared with you, Matthew 5:3, to become poor in spirit. Now, a lot of people, when they think, oh, to become poor in spirit, what does that mean? I got to sell my house. I got to sell my cars. I got to sell everything I have and just live in poverty. We think a material mindset toward it. That's not what poor in spirit means when Jesus was sharing that with us in the Beatitudes. He's saying, you take everything within you and you empty yourself. You empty those passions and those desires. You bring them to me and allow me to heal you. Allow me to set you free. So becoming poor of spirit, and it says, those who are in poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God within us. There's this process as the healing comes where the kingdom of God is formed within us. And every day in our journey with God, we take steps to allow the kingdom of God to be formed within us. It was the early church's belief when the apostles taught, we hit on that last week, we want to go back to the purest source. Because we know with a stream, the purest source of a stream is at the very beginning of that stream. So when we find out what the Christian faith is all about, we have to go back to what the purest source is, what the apostles taught us, what the early church taught us. And what the early church taught is that when you cooperate with the Holy Spirit and you allow your passions to be healed, he strengthens you, and Christ's likeness is formed within you. Don't we all want Christ's likeness to be formed within us? This is a part of this healing process, that when we take ourselves, we become poor in spirit, we present our lives before God on the altar, Christ's likeness begins to be formed within us, and we start to grow into who God has called us to be. Does that make sense? Are you seeing this process? Is it becoming real and alive to you? That it just doesn't happen. God gives us this blueprint of how we're to have the kingdom of God formed within us and how he desires for us to cooperate with the Holy Spirit. Think of, for example, a story in the Bible with Mary. When God had appeared to Mary and said, you're going to conceive the Son of God. She could have said, no, I don't want to do that. She could have freaked out and said no to the plan that God had upon her life. But what did she decide to do? She might have not understood everything. She might have been fearful, but she decided to cooperate with the Holy Spirit. And look how God used Mary. God wants to use you. Are you wanting to cooperate with the Holy Spirit? Do you want to cooperate with the Holy Spirit? I know I do. Because God desires for us to enjoy him. He wants us to enjoy this life. He wants us to live life and live it more abundantly. He wants us to enjoy it, not just suffer through it. We hit on last week, it's not a ticket mentality. We just don't get saved to get a ticket, and then one day when we die, we get to go to heaven. He wants us to be fruitful here on earth. He wants us to multiply. He wants us to live in calling and destiny and purpose. And that purpose is seen, parents, in raising your kids, your grandkids, the job he has for you in this life. Because you just don't have to be standing here or have some position in a church to change the world. This is supposed to inspire you to take it outside these four walls and take it out and do it there. That's where real change happens. You come in, you get healed, you take the healing out there, you touch your families, you touch those, your coworkers. If we can start thinking this way, watch what will start to happen in the world around you. Where we're not supposed to come to church and just try to hide from all the bad things going on. We come in, we get strengthened, and then we go out and we change the world. Because when Jesus came and he built an army, and that army is the church. Yes. We're soldiers. This is our basic training right here, right now, so that we can go out there and we can be effective. The parable in Matthew 13 says it perfectly, of how we're to have dominion, of how we're to heal those passions in our lives and come under the authority of Christ. Matthew 13:44 says, if you turn your Bibles there, it'll be on the screen. It says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and hid. And for joy, circle that word joy, and for joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the parable after that, verse 45, it says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant seeking beautiful pearls, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. So we have to ask, what does it mean to sell everything? He says, I sold everything to get this treasure, which the treasure is Christ. So what is this man selling in this parable? We have to ask ourselves this. What is he selling, and what are we supposed to sell when we find this treasure? Now, again, if we just think in a material way, do I have to go sell my house, all this kind of stuff, and you know, just give it away? The deeper thought here of what Jesus is sharing through this parable is he's wanting us to sell those worldly, broken passions. He's wanting us to sell the passions of lust, of pride, of envy, dishonesty, selfishness, our ego, the worldly cares we have, anger, despondency, greed, laziness, gluttony. You guys get in the picture. These are the passions that this man, when he found the kingdom of heaven, I don't want this in my life anymore. I'm going to sell it, and I'm going to go over here, and I'm going to pick up this treasure because of what it means to me. And I want to take on Christ. I want to become, again, this man is becoming poor in spirit. And I don't know about you, but that sounds like a pretty good trade. We get to trade all this stuff, and we get to go after this priceless treasure, which is Jesus Christ. These are the passions he wants to heal within us. Because think if we operated in those passions, nothing good ever happens when we allow those passions to take control of us, when we allow our emotions to get the best of us. When in a relationship, when we look outside the context of marriage, adultery, bad things happen. These are passions that God desires to heal within us, and he uses the church. The Spirit of God comes and he heals those passions where they don't have a grip and pull you into a pit and have a hold over your life. Amen. Amen. And that's why I'm fired up this morning, because I don't want these passions to have a grip on your life. And he gives us a formula. He gives us a blueprint of how we sell all this and we pick up the fruits of the Spirit in our life. That's the exchange yes. that takes place. And that's the exchange he desires for your life, is to sell everything, pick up this treasure, and watch as the fruits of the Spirit start to grow and to cultivate in your life. And I love it because it said, and for the joy. It is a joy to sell this and pick up this. That should make you happy. That should make you shout. That should make you worship a little different. That should make it so easy to be obedient, because you know when the Spirit of God touches you and is asking something of you, he's wanting to say, hey, put this down and trade up. With God, we're always trading up. But the devil wants to entice us and make it look, you don't want to let that go. You don't want to deal with that. It's going to be messy. He wants to always make this pizza over here look much more delicious than that generic pizza, than a La Rosa's buddy pizza. Come on. He wants us to settle for average. He wants us to settle just average. Where God wants to give us life abundantly. He wants us to trade. And when we understand the value that's here, because if you don't understand the value that's over here, you're going to be content over there. If you don't know anything about cars, you might see one car, they look both the same, but you don't know what's under the hood. You don't understand the value of how good this car is, because they both just look the same. But when you know about the engine, when you know what kind of tires it's got on it, when you know the intricate parts of it, you're going to get excited when you see that. Right. Might look the same on the outside, but it's different on the inside. The kingdom of God is a treasure. So what are some action steps of how we allow the kingdom of God to become real in our life? I'm going to give you another Greek word this morning. We learned last week the word theanthropic, that there's this divine aspect to the church, and there's this human aspect, and Jesus is in the middle pulling both of us together, and how Jesus is that bridge to bring heaven to earth and to bring us close to him. Our word this morning is metanoia. It's a Greek word, metanoia, and what it means is repentance. And like we talked of last week, when we don't understand the fullness of the word repentance or the fruits of the Spirit, when we don't understand the richness in it, we miss the depth of it and we miss how it can touch and change our life. So when you see, like the script that says, hang on to every jot and every tittle in the Word of God, the reason it says that is because there's so much power and so much depth and so much fruit when you bite into it. It wants to be juicy and just fall all over your face. That's how rich God's Word is. And that's why sometimes I'll just stay in a scripture all day and just be meditating on it, looking up context and commentary to get the fullness of it, because that's where God desires this church to be. We're not going to be shallow. We're going to go into the fullness because we want to understand the value of what we have. Don't you want to understand the value of what you have? If you don't understand the value of your house when you go to sell it, you're not going to list it at the right price, and you're not going to get the full price of what you were looking to get. You got to understand, know the value of it. And then when you know the value of it, you walk a little differently. You talk differently. You understand your identity. You understand who God is. But the devil has released an all-out attack on scarring the image of God, so you don't see him in his fullness. He wants you to think that he's mad at you. He wants you to think he wants to punish you. He does not want you to see who God really is in your life and what he really wants to do in your life. So we look at this word metanoia, we look at repentance. And when we repent, here's the thing with that early church, the purest stream of Christianity, of how the apostles held this repentance, how they held this metanoia. It wasn't just a one-time confession. It wasn't this, okay, I repent and I'm good and I never think about repentance again. Repentance was an everyday thing for these apostles. And they cherish repentance. Because when you repent, Matthew 5:3 comes alive and you become poor in spirit. You empty yourself out so you can be filled with God. You can be filled with his Holy Spirit. It basically means when I repent, my thinking is going to be changed. I was thinking this way and it made me go to this basic thing and this average way of thinking. But when you repent, it's so much more than just turning around and walking this way. You turn around, and as you're walking toward the treasure, your thinking's becoming healed. The way you see things are becoming healed. When we repent, healing comes into our life. And we give God the room to say, come and do what you want to do. There was this simple but profound and such deep prayer that the apostles prayed. And as you go in, if you're a church history guru, you'll see this prayer all over the place. But it was a prayer, and it was known as the Jesus Prayer. And this is what the apostles prayed every day. And the prayer was, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, for I am a sinner. Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy on me, for I am a sinner. They didn't pride themselves up and, I'm an apostle. They got real with themselves, and they knew that they were nothing without God. The devil wants to bring pride into your walk with him where you don't address the issues in your life. Because he knows if we don't address, if we can't walk in humility, then we won't empty ourselves out, and our passions and our desires can't be healed. That's why as we go back to Galatians 5:24, we crucify those passions and desires. That's a part of this healing journey that we are on in life. Is that we take all of these things that our mind, our will, our emotions, and we put them before the cross and he heals them. That's why we're ever growing in Christianity. We don't arrive. He's maturing us. Because normal Christianity, that purest stream of what Jesus came to establish, that church and what it looked like, normal Christianity produced mature believers. We just didn't stay as a baby, or we didn't stay coddled all the time. We walked into maturity. We knew who our God was. We knew what he called us to do. We didn't just settle. We just didn't get saved and then stayed in our mess. So many people, they get saved and they just stay in a mess. That's never what God intended. But when we understand that we pray, Lord Jesus Christ, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. I'm going to fall short. Then we don't let pride get built up. And when we mess up, we don't feel like everyone's out to judge us. Everyone's out to look at us. We're able to stand before God humbly and boldly approach that throne room of grace and get repentance and get back on the path toward fullness. We're always going toward fullness. We're always going toward maturity. And the formula that the apostles saw and that Jesus taught them is you empty yourself. You take your passions, your desires, you crucify them. You bring them before the cross. Because he wants to lead us into this treasure. And how do we get to the treasure? We sell everything. We go with full abandonment. We don't just stay in our mess. And as we're on this process of repentance, our life, every area of our life, it starts to become way more about him than it is about ourselves. It's always about him. It's not about us. And so there's three different ways when temptation comes into our life, how we deal with it. And I think we can all identify with this. Is we know that temptation is inevitable. Temptation is going to come. You can't just hide away and not expect to be tempted. Because even if you do hide, he'll just tempt your mind. So we know temptation is going to come. So we have to know how to handle temptation when it comes. So there's one way, is when we get tempted, we either give in to it immediately, and we go ahead and we just sin. We do that thing. Or number two, we try to ward off the temptation in our own will. And this is where a lot of Christians are. We just try to do it in our own strength. We just try to discipline ourselves enough. Whenever we really deal with the issue, we just try to lock ourselves up and we don't allow that thing to get within us. So we either fall into it, we try to deal with it in our own will, in our own power, or we go before God in prayer. This is the way that that we're to be healed when temptation comes. And this is how we're supposed to have strength when temptation comes. We go before God in prayer. As that happens, our soul is filled with the grace and the power of God that the temptation can have no effect. The temptation is there, but it's not going to have an effect on you because you can see it. If you struggled with alcohol at one point in your life, and you try to overcome this addiction by just, I'm not going to drink. I'm not going to drink. I'm not going to drink. But you never deal with what's inside of you, you're not really healed. But when you, now that's a part of it. You say, I'm not going to drink. If you want to be healed, that's the first step. You're not going to pick the bottle up. But when you say, I'm not going to drink, and then you go before God in repentance and say humbly, have mercy on me, for I'm a sinner. I need you, God. I empty myself. I give this passion to you, this addiction in my life. And that's when the power and the grace of God comes upon you, where it's not even desirable. You don't even start thinking about that. You're so focused on him that he's transforming you where you don't even look back anymore. That's where we miss healing and freedom, is we just say, I'm not going to do it anymore. I'm not going to look at that anymore. I'm not going to go there anymore. We just try to beat the problem by focusing on the problem, but we beat our problems by focusing on him. We beat the sin in our lives by focusing on him, because an exchange is taking place where we're emptying ourselves, we're giving him these passions, the mind of Christ is forming within us, and then he heals those areas of our lives. Is that making sense? Yes. You grabbing this?
Yes.
This is how we find true healing and freedom in our life, and Scripture is so rich and full of it, of how we're supposed to grab hold of it.
Right.
A Scripture we love here that Mr. Schubat brought out was 1 John 3:8, that Jesus came, Jesus manifested himself to destroy the works of the devil. He came to destroy the works of the devil. Because 1 John 3:6, a scripture before this says, no one who abides in Christ sins. When you're in Christ, sin has no sting, sin has no power over your life. But it's our job to make sure we're staying in that healing process, that we don't step out of it. Because the devil knows if he can step out of it, what did he do again to Adam and Eve? He enticed them and kind of lured them out of that place with God.
Yes.
So you have to understand that your devil, he's whispering, he's saying, come here, come look at this. The grass is greener over here. He's whispering to that area in your life that he knows where you're vulnerable to try to pull you off. But that's the beauty of God, that again, he's not mad at you. When you mess up, condemnation should never hit you.
Yes.
We should be quick to say, Father God, have mercy on me, for I'm a sinner. Heal me, Father. And even throughout the day, this is just a prayer I pray, because we all fall short. None of us, like Paul said, he's the chief of all sinners. I'm here to tell you that I'm not perfect. I fall short. I'm on the same journey all you are. So we fall short in our life. We have to understand that. And we can't puff ourselves up in pride. We can't puff ourselves up, and when our brother falls, that we judge him and say, look at him. We're called to be healed and then go and help that brother, help that sister through what they're going through. We have to understand that Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. When you take on the power of God, the works of the devil get destroyed in your life, and that's where you find deliverance.
Yes.
Amen. That's why we sing that song, that song so simple. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So real quick, three things that keep you from having this process of your passions being healed. It's ignorance, forgetfulness, and laziness. It's how the devil wants to come and keep your passions from getting healed. He wants to keep you ignorant. Scripture says that my people perish for lack of knowledge. If the devil can keep you ignorant of God's word, you'll never grow. If he can keep you out of God's word, out of church, out of the things that are going to grow your life, then ignorance can rob you of the destiny that God has for you. Again, that's why we're not lazy Christians. We get in God's word, we consume it, we eat it. It is our lifeline. Without it, we can do nothing. Forgetfulness. You look at the parable of the sower, how the different types of soil. And one of those soils was, when he walked away, it's like it was snatched out. The devil wants, when you walk out of here, wants to put all these cares, all these things right back in your life where you forget what was said. And you forget what God was doing in your life as you're here this morning. Or he wants to pull the word of God in your quiet times where you don't know, where you forget, where you don't get the fullness of it. He wants to keep you distracted. He wants to keep you busy. See, we don't see busyness as a bad thing. It's not a sin.
Right.
But the devil uses it to keep us distracted and keep us out of the word of God. And then laziness says it for itself. We can't be lazy. We have to pick up the book. We have to put ourselves in a place where we can hear from God, where we can receive what God wants to say. And the thing is, we can do this. You can do this. Don't be passive about it. Attack it. Get it, and watch as the chains start falling off your life. Watch as your mind is healed. Watch as your physical being is healed. Watch as this food or all these sweets that are causing bad health in you, that's healed within you.
Yes.
Maybe you have an addiction with pornography. Stop just saying, I'm not going to look at it, I'm not going to look at it. Focus on Him, allow Him to heal that area in your life, and watch as that chain falls and that's healed within you. And then God moves it in the right place, in the context of that marriage, in the context of that. Because here's the thing, and we're going to get into this in a couple weeks in the mystery of marriage. You know, sex is not a bad thing. God designed a plan and a place for it to be beautiful and for it to be awesome. But, and look how much the Bible talks about sex and how the devil knew the power of that and how the devil wanted to totally ruin it and mess up mankind with that. But if we know the way God intended it to be, there's a blessing with it. And if we've messed up, what do? We go before Him, we enter ourselves, we say, Holy Spirit, heal this passion, heal this desire, and get it back on track with You. There's no condemnation. God does not condemn. He wants to heal. So you allow Him to heal that area in your life. I'm telling you, if you can get real with God and you can wrestle with these areas, you'll find freedom and you'll find the life that God has intended you to live. Don't let taboo things, don't let things that you don't understand, because what we want to do when it comes to the things of God, if we don't understand it, we just don't even choose to go after it. The devil wants to keep you dumb. He wants to keep you a slave. Devil wants to keep you a slave. But you know what our passions? Our passions make us a slave if they're not focused in on what God has intended for us. But when we focus them, you know what happens? They become our servant. And they serve us to get us to where God wants us to be. Don't allow your passions to keep you a slave. Because as the song we sang, He's called you to be a son and a daughter of God. And this is the healing journey to get to that place. Amen. I want to pray for you this morning. Close your eyes with me. Father, we thank You that You want to heal us. You're not mad at us. God, we pray that. Have mercy on us. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, for I'm a sinner. God, we want to be real with ourselves. We want to examine ourselves. We want to bring ourselves before Your altar every day and say that Your kingdom come, Your will be done in my life. God, You're our lifeline. You're our source of hope. God, I thank You that we have hope in You, that when You came and You healed us so that we don't have to stay a mess. We don't have to stay emotionally immature. God, but that there is hope and that there is a path where we can have victory in our life through You, God. That our best days truly can be in front of us. That when we fall down, we get back up and we stay on this process of healing. God, I thank You this week as we go, You're going to heal and touch Your people like never before. God, bring things up so that we can bring that passion, bring that desire before the cross of Christ, and we can find healing. That You heal our crippled will, Father, and You make us strong, that we want to cooperate with You, Holy Spirit. Deposit that strength within Your church this morning, God. Let us not leave here the same. We love You. We give our lives to You. Speak to us, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.